thanks very much. It is 1 o'clock, so we'll start this evening, and apologies to any of the members who have been disrupted by somebody who gave their apologies and then potentially turned up, so apologies for that. So this start and proceedings. Good afternoon, colleagues. Can we make certain that all phones are switched off or silent? And when people are speaking, if they can get as close to the microphones as possible so that everybody in the gallery can hear us. Item one is apologies. I already have some apologies. Trudy?
Yes, we've received apologies from Councillor Terry O'Neill, Jane Kennedy, Barbara Spicer, Lou Collins, and Reverend Canon Dr. Ellen Loudon.
And can we add Mayor Johansson and Frank Rogers is also any further apologies? Okay, item two, are there any declarations? Three is the minutes of the previous meeting of the Combined Authority held on the 2nd of February 2018. Can we agree those minutes, please? Agreed. Item four is just to update people on what's happened since we last met, and again, hopefully people will be aware that this week is National Apprenticeship Week, and that's meant that myself and Councillor Mayor have been around a number of organisations having a look at what they are doing. We visited some construction apprentices at John Moores University. Those people were doing NVQ level 6, which is degree level. I think it's something that will really start to come to the fore in the next few years. Our universities and FE providers are certainly looking at those alternative options for people who want to achieve a high level of qualification but not necessarily go to university on an academic route. Myself and Ian went to the launch of our apprenticeship growth plan, which commits us to target 20,000 apprentices and starts in the city region by 2020. Despite the difficulty many employers are having in recruiting apprentices because of the introduction of the government's apprenticeship levy, I believe that the actions that we're taking here in our city region can ensure that young people have the skills that they need to succeed in the future, and we're monitoring that very closely. 2 weeks ago, the Combined Authority launched our Household Into Work programme, again, a piece of work that Councillor Mayor has been involved in since its inception. And the programme involves a new team of 24 advocates who help 800 unemployed families into work across the city and region. And the advocates will be based in each of the 6 local authority areas and will identify the barriers that stop people getting into work, such as childcare issues, debt, lack of skills, and they'll put a bespoke programme together to support each individual to get them back into work. On Friday the 23rd of February, we held the Liverpool City Region's Housing Summit and challenged house builders to make our region an exemplar for innovation, sustainability and design excellence. And I was joined by Mayor Joe Anderson, who also spoke at the summit about the great work that Liverpool City Council are doing to build 10,000 homes through what's called its foundations, its own housing company. And then a few days later, Whittle was the latest stop in the community engagement day, and as part of that engagement I met with students at Bevins High School and I heard from the council about their plans for growth and the Whittle Growth Company. Councillor Davis has already discussed this. If you want to know any of the details, please talk to him, not me. But we also discussed energy policy at a round table. Local businesses were there, but also other stakeholders. And we saw the blueprints for the Whittle Water Scheme, which is at a large scale, £4.5 billion development, which we hope now will come to fruition. Last month, it's one of those things that you get the pleasure of doing sometimes. I spoke at the Liverpool City Region Health and Wellbeing Summit in Nosy, and it was a great opportunity for experts from all across the city region and across the sector to share best practice when it comes to improving health and wellbeing of people across the city region. And I at the summit. I joined Councillor Andrew Moorhead, who's leader of Leeds, and the Liverpool City Region portfolio holder North, in signing a pledge to build a dementia-friendly city region game. Believing in the whole country, we're the first to do this, just the same we did with an autism-friendly city region. And just to conclude, an influential report by global design and infrastructure consultancy expert Arcadis has identified the Liverpool city region as one of the UK's top four growth hotspots. And amongst our key strengths are our brand, infrastructure investment, positive business environment, and the quality and affordability of housing supply. So it's a really encouraging report. If you haven't seen it, I think you should do, but it gives a sense of what we already know, and that we're a city region doing great things, and devolution gives us a huge opportunity to further realise that potential. It was really interesting for me that we were ahead Birmingham, Manchester, and even London. So again, at the vanguard of progress that is being made. Item 5 is the Liverpool City Region Single Investment Fund. The report seeks the approval of the award of £25,109,044 from the SIF Fund, specifically for Local Growth Fund 3 and for the Key Route Network. And Nick Moon is going to take us through this report.
I remember the recall in October. There was a recall in October of last year that a agreement was given to invest in this £25 million of LGF3 funding into the city region's key route network of our most important strategic roads across the whole city region. The full business case appraisal has now been prepared centrally, involving all the districts as well as Merthyr Tydfil, and has been independently appraised in line with the SIF framework, and it's been found to be website compliant, so that's according to the Green Book. The overall programme has been assessed as having what we call a BCR, best benefit cost ratio of 9.9, which represents very high value for money. The programme involves, as I say, all six districts in Merthyr Tydfil, and will take forward 15 discrete interventions which have been drawn from the City Region's transport investment pipeline. In assessing which schemes are going to go forward, consideration was given to the deliverability of these schemes. And all 15 that we now recommend are deemed to be in a state of readiness to commence this coming financial year. More information on the programme, the list of schemes, how they're categorised, is given in the appendix 1 to the report. I would ask the members to note that the call on LTF3 is £109,000 higher than the original commission expected. Therefore, that there will be a need for a compensation reduction in the remaining funds available for LGF3 transport-related projects. So with that in mind, Chair, I'd ask members if they would consider approving the recommendation set out on page 7 of the report.
Are there any questions? Therefore, can we agree the recommendation as set out on page 7? Item 6 is the report that seeks approval for the Liverpool City Region Culture and Creative Strategy for 2018 to 2048. Councillor Davis is going to take us through this presentation.
Okay, thanks, Steve. So this is asking the combined authority to agree the culture and creativity strategy for the city region. First slide really just highlights the benefit really of the of culture to the city region. So as the top box makes clear there, I think this is a really powerful statistic. For every £1 of local authority investment in culture, we can see a benefit of £11.14 to the city region. So it is a major economic contributor to the wealth of the city region. The the benefit in terms of jobs is about 51,000, and the Vista economy, which is part of the culture offer, generates about 4.3 billion of economic benefit. So it's a major economic contributor. So where are we with the strategy? We have done a very exhaustive consultation exercise on the strategy, involved all the key arts and cultural organisations. We've had borough-wide cultural conversations in each of the six districts. It's a key part of our devolution deal, and I'm really, really pleased that we've got, for the first time, a cultural plan agreed for the city region. I think it's the first time we've had a single plan that brings together all of the strengths and the benefits of culture for the city region. It's a 30-year strategy, but it's got an action plan, a very practical action plan for the first 3 years, which focuses on three key elements. The first is a Boroughs of Culture initiative, and the idea then with this is to have a showcase, a year where we're showcasing the best of arts and culture in each of the six boroughs. And I'm really pleased, and I want to thank the leaders. We've got a kind of batting order now, starting with St Helens to celebrate, Barry, your 150th kind of anniversary. So I think that's a really exciting initiative. And I think what we're trying to do is to link each of the borough, the borough's year of culture with a notable milestone or notable event in that borough. The second key deliverable is an annual cultural awards ceremony, and there the aim is to really champion the best of what communities, particularly the local aspect of arts and culture, what communities in each of the boroughs are doing. And then thirdly, a calendar of region-wide events developing the best in the city region. And I think those three deliverables will capture the public's imagination, but crucially will also attract significant external resources into the bargain. So I think this is a real milestone event. It's the first time I think any city region has really been so upfront with a cultural plan. And I think what it does, it sends a clear message that Liverpool City Region sees art and culture as the kind of economic driving force for taking the economy forward, and as a major contributor to growth within the world economy. Okay, so in terms of what the combined authority asks are, so we're asking the CA to endorse the culture and creativity 30-year strategy. And then secondly, we're asking for support for those three key deliverables that I mentioned. And the specific requirement is a contribution of £300,000 from the mayoral priority budget for 18-19. This hook that I think is a really good kind of selling point, percent for art, and also to agree that this should be an annual contribution from the mayoral priority budget, pending the availability of that external funding. And what I would say on that, Steve, is that we've had, as part of this work, some really productive and positive meetings with bodies like the Arts Council, who have absolutely said that they want to get behind this initiative, and I'm very confident that we will get the additional funding. But the money we're asking for from the mayoral priority budget is really to kickstart this programme. And obviously we'll bring regular reports back to the CA on how we're doing in terms of delivering this ambitious agenda. So next steps. So we want to launch the culture and creativity strategy, having agreed today. We want to launch it formally in May. We want to hold the launch event in St Helens to coincide with the 150th anniversary. And as I said, St Helens will be the first borough of culture to really showcase the best of what they can bring to the table in terms of their arts and culture offer. And to mark this milestone year, I know that we're already in conversations with St Helens about a very exciting programme of arts, culture and community events which is being developed. So in closing, I think this is a really excellent strategy. I think it's a very practical, deliverable programme, and I think it's something that you know, we can say we are the first city region to have really embraced. So I think that's it, Steve. Happy to take any questions.
Thanks, Phil. A couple of questions. Andy, go ahead first, and then Matt.
Thanks, Steve. Again, thanks for this. It was fantastic. Obviously, the case is something like a missile place to be. Our contribution will be in 2020. We coincide with the opening of Shakespeare's in North. We're planning on the Elizabethan year of events with that. I think that I'm sort of Phil Redmond a while ago shared the City Region Cultural Partnership. And I know his wife's a star second. Patrick Stewart was and is a fantastic actor, and he's done a hell of a lot of Shakespeare in his brother's part. I think most of us will say, which somebody says now, let's make it so.
If I can follow. One thing Andy mentioned, I just would like to pay tribute to Phil Redmond. Phil Redmond chairs the Cultural Partnership, and I think he's done an excellent job in steering this plan. And you know, and we've got all the key organisations sitting on the Cultural Partnership. I want also pay tribute to three other officers, please, Steve, if I can, while I've got the opportunity. Paula Williams, Lucy Barrow and Rachel Howie have been absolutely fantastic in driving this plan forward from the get-go, and you know, they've really gone the extra mile to get to the place that we are today. So thank you to them.
I think Andy's opened up the opportunity for any further puns. I was going to say let's hope it's not a comedy of errors, but other people I'm sure have got better suggestions than that.
I saw Patrick Stewart's and imagine that was fantastic. It's really important, isn't it, that all of the local authorities have recognised the importance of culture during this extended period of austerity, something that's not statutory that we could have easily cut, and I know there are other parts of the country now. We recognise the investment that culture has for our city and the city region. And what I thought was really interesting was the fact that we will be working within all of our communities, because it's so easy just to do it in, you know, in each of the hubs rather than spreading it out, and because culture's for everyone, it's not elitist, it's not exclusive, it's supposed to be inclusive. So the idea of the awards and making sure that all of our communities are engaged is fantastic.
Yeah, I mean, I think that was one of the key sort of red lines that we're working on from day one. This has got to be owned by the community, and it can't just be one or two boroughs. It's got to be all six of us. Because there is some fantastic work that's going on that doesn't often get showcased, that doesn't often get mentioned. And the fact that everybody, each of the six boroughs, is guaranteed a year to showcase the best, I think that means that no one will be left behind. So I think it's really, really important.
Can we agree the recommendations set out on page 21? Thanks, Phil. Also echo the comments about the officer engagement, which has produced, I think, an absolutely fantastic report. Especially as the 1% of funding, the gain share funding that goes to arts and culture, again, we are the first city region in the country to commit to this. So fantastic work by everybody involved. Item 7 is the proposal for the creation of a major road network, and the report brings to our attention a consultation by the DFT on their proposals, and Councillor Hodgson will take us through this report.
Thanks very much. As you just alluded to, the DFT's running a consultation on the creation of a major road network. That's not the same as the strategic road network, which is the network that Highways England run, which is principally the motorway network and the trunk road network. Now, the consultation on a major road network is actually about the key local authority A roads that local authorities control. It's going through a variety of different aspects, like the definition of that network, which roads would we wish to see included, how investment is planned on those, and also how funding is pulled together, both from a national and a local source as well. The response is just being finalised with all our district colleagues and also working with Transport for the North. But some of the things that are going to be included in that, because whilst we've got broad agreement on some of the core principles, the DFT has got it there. We would like to see much more clarity on what match funding may be required from a local level in terms of what we're looking for. How some of the traffic flows are being calculated to make sure that those are accurate. Some of the roads that we would like to see identified in our part of the world as part of that major road network. And also seeking clarity about our role as local authorities, but also other national bodies, how they'll be involved in. We've also got a slight disagreement as well that one of the proposals is that to qualify for national funding, the schemes that would be outlined would have to be between 20 million and 100 million, and we actually think that 20 million lower limit is far too high. So we're putting all those things together. Obviously, it's not finalised yet. It will get circulated to all members of the combined authority for submission, but the report actually seeks delegated authority for the mayor to sign it off, so we can submit it before the 19th of March deadline.
Any questions for you? Okay, can we agree the recommendations as set out on page 53? Item 8 is the report which presents the final version of the Liverpool City Region Skills Strategy. This is for approval, and Councillor Mayor will take us through this report.
Thanks, Chief. The skills strategy, skills will be and is, remains a real cornerstone of our DPCS. We believe that having an influence, understanding what our employers and what our businesses need, needs to be aligned with our people's skills and how we drive that forward. We genuinely believe and still believe that that influence, control, whatever you want to call it, at local level, will be a much improved add to what we have had to date. Chair, the draft skills strategy came to us in December last year, and that was subject to a final consultation. Went out for a final consultation, we got some 35 responses, which contained over 200 detailed comments. They've been taken on board in drafting a revised version of the key changes in that set out in section 3.2 of the report. I just want to make a point that the main focus of the strategy does remain in line with the draft version. We've also been working on implementation of the GUM action plan, including linking up with employers' networks with skilled provider networks, using technology to collect and produce information, and looking at how we better aggregate employer demand. This version, Chair, also added a performance framework for performance measures, which includes 5-year projections on delivery. It really is difficult to be more precise on these and produce targets, given the wider economic uncertainty that we face at this moment in time in this country. And reporting against this and the action plan will take place at the annual skills summit. The report also asks for acceptance of some grant funding to support the implementation of the adult education budget, which, as we know, is being devolved, it's supposed to already be devolved, but is being devolved to us, and this will help us. It's a time-limited funding, and it will help us to prepare for the evolution of this funding next year. J, just some examples of good practice and things that's going on from the report. The Youth Employment Gateway, the YEG, as often people call it, supports some 2,000 young people into work with some innovative approaches, including personal budgets and an app to help them do that. And that's mentioned on page 94 of the report. We support employment pathways to help young people with learning disabilities into their really important issue, and that's on page 92. We've got an aggregation of employers demand at Desbury through independent skills brokerage, and that's on page 95. We've also, we've invested in college facilities to meet the needs of employers, such as the Port Academy in Newburn and Bootle and the Idea Centre Riverside in Carlton, also mentioned on page 92. And it's probably significant, Chair, that this strategy comes here today at the launch of our apprentice week. I'll finish there.
Thanks very much. I think I'll just join you in thanking Sue Jarvis and their team as well for all you've put into.
Thank you for
the I'm sure that's what you're going to say. Quite sure that's what you're going to say. Are there any questions for Councillor Mayor?
Thanks very much for the report. Just to reiterate, there's a lot of hard work on it. Again, just to reiterate, the skills are key to the input for our city region, for the business community. I think one of the key fundamentals about this core project is actually taking and translating the strategy into real projects, which in many ways game changers. I think we've got to make a step change in the city region to ensure our ambitions are met. With that, what I'd like to say is that I think we should take the actual strategic plan and we should also bring it back into the LET board as well to consult with the businesses where they need it, if everyone's in agreement with that as well. So just an addition to that.
Is that
agreed,
Councillor Mayor?
Yeah.
Is everybody agreed with that? Okay, can we then, therefore, with that and an approved recommendation, can we agree all the recommendations set out on page 57? Item nine is the Urban Development Fund. This report seeks approval to progress an application to the Ministry for Housing Communities and the Local Government, now known as the Ministry, for the establishment of an Urban Development Fund. And should the application be successful, this fund will provide the city region with a single opportunity, a significant opportunity, to support property, research and development and low carbon investments. And John Fogarty is going to take us through briefly this report.
Thank you. Just briefly, first and foremost, this would be a long fund. The work we've already undertaken shows that there's a clear demand for funding of this nature, particularly around, as you say, R&D, property and low carbon agenda. It would become another lever within the single investment fund approach, so we would need to manage this as part of a total funding package that would include and sit alongside Chrysalis, LGF, Genshin, etc. But the ability that gives us to coordinate those funds alongside this one is really part of the benefit of that benefit of a single fund approach. As I say, it would become another lever within that overall funding framework. In terms of process, because of timing, there would be also a need to delegate to the Jermaine Pay Service, Frank Rogers, the Metro Mayor and myself, the ability to actually bid for this. Any questions on it, I'm happy to answer.
Are there any questions?
Just a comment here that it's really important that Liverpool and the country as a whole, given what's going on with Brexit, doesn't lose this funding that's coming to us, given how strongly Europe has supported the Liverpool City region over the years. And this is a really imaginative way to make sure that we are spending the money that's available to us to onto small businesses and those that wish to make sure we elevate the city region. So it's a really good piece of work that's been done by the team.
Thanks for that. Can we agree then the recommendations are set out on page 101? Agreed. 10 is, it's the first completed review received from the Overview and Scrutiny Committee. And therefore, before I invite Councillor Maguire to present the report, I'd like to take this opportunity to thank all of the members of the Overview and Scrutiny Committee for undertaking this review and providing a number of recommendations for our consideration. So I'll ask Councillor Maguire to submit that report.
Thank you very much, Chair. It is my pleasure to present the findings and recommendations of my committee's recent review of the spatial development strategy. The aim of the review was to consider the process for preparing the Liverpool City Region Spatial Development Strategy Programme by understanding the stages which need to be achieved to get the LCR Spatial Development Strategy adopted, and to also learn from best practice from other areas. During the course of the review, it was evident that the creation of the SDS for the Liverpool City Region would be challenging, particularly to achieve the timescales as set out in the devolution deal. However, it was noted that it was important to keep government engaged in the planning process and updated on the achievement of key milestones. The evidence gathered during the course of the review confirmed that there was a positive relationship across the constituent councils from across the city region, which should bode well for the delivery of the SDS. From the experience of the Greater London Assembly, it was noted that having a plan which contained a significant number of policies was challenging. Therefore, from the evidence received, it was recognised that the SDS should be focused on high-level strategic issues. This has led the committee to make a number of recommendations which we feel will make a significant contribution to supporting the development of the strategy, strategic development strategy, including a request for funding to be made available for the necessary work to be undertaken in accordance with the devolution deal timeframe. Before I finish, I would like particularly to thank my fellow committee members who played an active and engaging part in this review, Darren Richards and Rachel Rooney from the Greater London Assembly for their insight into the development of the London Plan, Keith Holland from the Planning Advisory Service for giving us his perspective on the key milestones needed to be achieved to ensure the SDS was implemented, and the officers who played a key role in supporting this review, ensuring we had the evidence upon which we could base our recommendations. In conclusion, I am happy to present this report and its recommendations to the combined authority for your consideration and look forward to your response.
Thank you, Councillor Maguire. Thank you for all the excellent work under your stewardship. Councillor Grunwald is going to respond, he's the portfolio holder, and it's just a brief response and then we'll go on to the recommendations.
I'd like to thank Councillor Maguire for her report and to thank Scrutiny for their work on the spatial strategy and for their recommendations. What response to the recommendations and on how we will incorporate the views of Scrutiny into the next stage of the process? The capacity was a key issue identified by Scrutiny members. The authority has recently advertised for ahead planning to provide resources to work on this process. And since the Scrutiny work was undertaken, the combined authority has been awarded over £200,000 to support the development of the spatial plan after a successful bit of government. Hopefully address some of the points raised. Is working on the project would be happy to report back to the Scrutiny on progress later this year.
I think the main point of that, Councillor Bryan, that we have received £200,000, so we can get a spatial frame of development. We will incorporate Scrutiny from your findings into future processes, and we will report back later this year on the progress that we make.
Thank you.
Thank you. Are there any questions? Okay, can we agree the recommendations which are on page 119? Item 11 is the Combined Authority Budget Monitoring Statement, and the report provides a budget update on the third quarter of 2017-18 and an update on the progress of SIF and Local Growth Fund 1 and 2 allocations. And John, is there anything that you need to draw our attention to?
Not especially. The big ticket items, which are around funding of transport predominantly, are all within budget and will have to at or around the budget that was agreed last February. That's the same also for tunnel tolls, which is the main source of income other than current funding. The CH running costs will continue to be monitored, but we're now looking to show a slight underspend at the year end. The issue of the SIF in particular and gain sharing and LGF is simply one of timing. So on revenue, there's certain revenue costs associated with IFB and cultural events that will fall into the next financial year, but it will still be within the overall award, and that is also the case for certain capital schemes within the SIF that are set out in the tables within the report. There is some slippage on the programme into next year, but there's nothing that at this stage gives us cause for a landlord that hasn't been agreed with the project sponsors. Any questions on the budget, we'll be happy to answer.
Any questions for John? Can we therefore agree the recommendations as set out on page 135? Now, we did get a question from William Shortall, which I'm sure we all know Bill. It doesn't appear that he's here. Is that correct? No, he's not here. Okay, so we'll answer that in 10 working days as normal. Therefore, could they invite Mr. Woodcock to read his question out, please?
Mayor Rotherham and members of the Combined Authority, Unlock Democracy values the opportunity at every meeting of this LCRCA to be able to ask questions when having given the required notice. We'd also welcome a similar arrangement at the important Overview and Scrutiny Committee, which has unfortunately been incorrect at its last two meetings. Could this question time provision be a regular item on the agenda of these meetings also?
Thank you for your question, Mr. Woodcock. As you know, we will provide a written response within 10 days, but thank you for that. Item 13, we've had no notification of petitions and statements within the deadline. So we go on to item 14, which is the minutes of the Transport Committee held on the 1st of February. Can we agree those minutes, please, Anna? On 15, it's the minutes of the City Region Appointments and Disciplinary Committee, which is held on the 28th of January 2018. Can we agree those?
Agreed.
I've not been informed of any urgent items, so the next meeting of the Combined Authority will take place on Friday, the 20th of April 2018 at 1 o'clock here. The Authority Chamber, and I declare the meeting will be closed. Thank you for your attendance.